The Leo and Danny Show.
Marlon,
let
me give you a little intro. Marlon Sims is the last name, right?
Yes, sir.
Marlon Sims is a UFC veteran, and I know Marlon from being involved in the most legendary moment of the reality show, The Ultimate Fighter history. The backyard brawl that we actually, I was nervous. I didn't think we could play it on here because Zuffa are fucking dicks, and I figured they would take it down. But there's a clip of the brawl in its entirety that's been up for 10 fucking years on YouTube.
Yeah.
I see no harm in letting it play out. People, if you're listening to this on Spotify, on Apple Podcasts, click over to the YouTube channel and take a look at this. You won't regret it.
You guys want me to set it up for the people that...
Set it up.
Even if you've seen it, it's... Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, they take a 1 week worth of footage and then edit it down into an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So prior to this, what you don't see is that there is a magic list on the TV show that all the fighters get to sign every morning. So you wake up in the morning and whatever you want to eat for that day, you write the magic list. And they tell you during the show from day one, anything you want, anything you order on that list that's legal is going to show up no matter what it is.
Wow.
Lobster, filet mignon. Wow. You know, I am and was then a huge foodie.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm getting prime cuts of center filet mignon and lobster.
Wait, what does that have to do with this brawl though?
That morning on the magic list, I requested a bottle of Cassidy Reposado.
And let's say, Marlon, I think we should probably even back up a little bit more. I think a good amount of our fans will know what this show is, but if you don't, The Ultimate Fighter was a reality show that basically put the UFC on the map. Before that, the UFC was doing shit like it could only fill its arenas to 40% capacity. They were putting in statues of gargoyles and ramps and fireworks to make it look legit. They were losing money every single show. They were on the brink of bankruptcy. But then the first season of The Ultimate Fighter came around. Forrest Griffin fought Stephen Bonner. Everybody told anybody who saw it, word of mouth, multiplied the viewership by like five from the start of the fight to the end. The sport of mixed martial arts had arrived in the mainstream.
Yeah.
Five seasons later, Marlon was on it along with Nate Diaz. And I personally think this was the best season.
Thank you.
The coach drama was excellent. Jens Pulver and BJ Penn actually hated each other.
Yeah.
They allowed alcohol, like Marlon partook in. Still, after this season, everybody wanted to be on a fucking Wheaties box and get a Nike sponsorship, so they were drinking smoothies.
Yeah.
This is when men were men.
Yeah.
And men fought in the fucking UFC. This was my favorite fucking season. This is the pinnacle moment. Austin, if you fuck this up right now, I'm going to have Marlon come over and kick you in the face. He does it right here. You're going to see his high kick.
Oh, shit.
That's great.
Yeah.
Let's
go.
Yes.
Fight. Fight. This is fucking awesome.
So, Noah, the Red is his nickname. This dude is 23 years old. He's a Marine sniper. He lives in Colorado. The only time he's been in Colorado in his entire existence was to go to Korea to train for 2 months.
Wow.
This kid knows everything. And when I tell you he knows everything,
I'm not getting kicked
out. He knows everything. There's no convincing him otherwise. Regardless if you were there, you saw it.
Are you ready?
Regardless if you're 10 years older than this guy is at this time, which I am.
All right, let's go.
All season, called me a liar, told me I was a fake, told me shit, told me that he could knock me out, break my arm, tear it off, and beat me to death with it.
Jesus.
And he's such a big, significant worm. I drank this half bottle of tequila. And he's sitting next to me, and we're at the fire, and Nate knows I hate him. Uh-huh. And Nate's like, "You're drunk enough? Good. All right, talk some shit to Noah." And he's sitting right next to me, so I say, "Yeah, you're a punk. Nobody likes you. Everybody hates you. And I already called you out for the finale. I'm gonna beat your ass." And he's like, "Well, you know, if I had my way,
yeah,
I'd tear your arm off and beat you with it." I said, "Okay. Well, where I come from, and after being on the show with you for..."
Look at you, bro.
I'm sure that's white boy wasted.
White boy wasted.
So also, I've talked about street fights. I've been getting into at this point how I like to
tap. No, there's no tap.
I spotted the concrete.
You spotted the concrete.
Dropped him on the concrete. That's why this episode is named Not on the Concrete, because that's all I do. I go, okay, this motherfucker wants to do jiu-jitsu.
I stop.
There you are, bro.
I'll take him to the hard concrete and see how he likes it.
That's right.
And then another cheap shot. So the first time he hit me, guys, my eyes are closed. My hands are in my pocket. My head's turned to the side. And I just say, go ahead. So that's cheap shot number two. And at this point, they edit. So,
and Marlon, they're actually getting the audio right now. They're going to have the audio.
Oh,
yeah.
He used to drunk one.
I just realized that Marlon doesn't have headphones, so he couldn't pick. He wasn't hearing that.
Sorry.
Oh, no problem.
It's all good. I liked it.
Dude, this needs to be played in its entirety. This is a great goddamn moment in reality history.
Yeah, you know, after what they're not showing right here is there's a break in the action, and I actually walk back into the bathroom. And I see that I'm bleeding, and I literally say out loud, nobody makes me bleed my own blood. And I come walking back outside, and I stand in front of this motherfucker.
Oh!
It is dropped.
Are you...
Oh, slippery. Oh. It's middle of winter.
Right.
It's very, very slippery, kind of, you know, green rock. So there's no footing whatsoever. And right now, he's having a fucking
hand. There it is. Oh. Oh.
Give him the fuck off.
The brutality of it all.
Oh, dumb fuck.
Guess what happens when somebody takes guard?
There it is. Dude. So, Marlon, we're going to resume our audio now.
Okay. Yeah.
And I think this is a good opportunity. I don't know if you want to say anything about that fight.
Yeah, I do, because there's, you know, editing is all nice and stuff. There was a break in the action there. Mm-hmm. It was like two rounds, basically. And after the after I'm banging his head on the grass and I'm ground and pounding mm-hmm. him, I realized that, you know, we're on national television. And it kind of, you know, it like it all comes full circle, because when you're wasted and you get hit and you all of a sudden the fight happens. I don't know if anybody out there can understand what I'm talking about, but you know, the adrenaline dump is so much more excessive,
right?
Because your blood is thinner. You're like, it comes on all at once and you gas quick.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like all of a sudden it just hits you and this wave comes mm-hmm. over you and you're like, oh man, okay, I'm tired.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point where I'm on top of him and I'm punching him, it all kind of hits me and I realize, wait a second, oh my God, I'm on TV, and why hasn't anybody stopped me? Why,
yeah.
Like, why isn't anybody, you know, this dude just cheap shotted me twice.
Right.
So in my head, I'm like, into the producers out loud, I'm like, why isn't anybody stopping this? This dude just fucking cheap shotted me twice. I'm realizing this dude just cheap shotted me twice and you guys are just leaving me out here to deal with it. Okay. So I know that the producers are on the other side of this wall 10 feet away, and I know they're all in the house, and there's 10 cameras on me, so I'm looking at all of them, and nobody's doing anything, and that's when Nate's like, all right, calm it down. I excuse myself, and I go to the bathroom. When I walk into the bathroom, my lip's cut, you know, and I can see the welt over my eye from where he decked me without gloves on and stuff, and I'm just like, fuck that. And I walk back out there and he's like, bro, dude, I'm fucking sorry. And he sticks his hand out and I look at his hand and I'm like, no. Nate's like, all right, look, you cheap shotted him twice. Are you guys cool? And I'm like, in my head is no, I'm not cool.
No.
He reaches his hand out and I'm like, no, fuck you. And what you guys don't get in the audio, and this was on my original DVD, is when I knock him out and he's falling like a brick when I starched him, I yell out, pride rules, bitch.
Yeah.
As I kick him
no
in the face.
Way.
Yeah, soccer kicks, knees to the head, it's all good.
So holy, I yell shit out as I'm going down, because I've done this a million times. I've knocked people out and followed up in Muay Thai you know, you finish when they hit the ground. So he's hitting the ground. I wake him back up with that round kick and bounce his head off the concrete and I yell out, pride rules, bitch. They cut that because they didn't know pride at that time and they could have got sued. So you guys don't get to hear that audio. But that audio is classic. My boys in Sonoma picked it up when they played the original preview clip of it, and they had it on video before they were told by the network you can't say that. So I have that originally, but that's something you guys don't hear, is that pride rules, bitch.
Yeah.
And then when it's over, when he verbally taps to me and he stands up, his head is he's got like a 3.5-inch gash over the back of his head.
Yeah.
You can see the blood already on his shirt from kind of like a squirt from just that instant he came off the ground.
Yeah.
But they show the next clip and his head's just, you know, you can see his skull for like three inches.
That's the danger of rolling for an arm bar on the concrete.